Hello. My project is massively parallel high-speed 3D functional photoacoustic tomography of the adult human brain. Optical imaging provides molecular specificity, but we face daunting challenges in penetration. Classical optical microscopy provides penetration up to only 100 microns, which is the aberration limit. Modern optical high-resolution imaging allows us to provide 10 times penetration at 1 millimeter, which is the optical diffusion limit. Photoacoustic tomography allows us to provide two orders of magnitude more penetration, up to multiple centimeters at human organ level. Today, I'll focus on photoacoustic tomography. We do face the next challenge, which is the optical dissipation limit. There's this very active field, but not very mature for practical use yet. It's called wavefront engineering or time reversal. In photoacoustic tomography, we typically use a nanosecond laser pulse. We broaden the laser beam such that the energy per area is within the safety limit. When photons diffuse deeply into biological tissue, photons are absorbed. Light absorption generates rapid heating. Every millidegree gives us 800 pascals of pressure, which is detectable already. Within the safety limit, we can heat up to hundreds of millidegrees. So we have a sufficient signal-to-noise ratio to work with. Unlike standard optical imaging, we detect acoustic signals. Acoustic scattering is much weaker than optical scattering by orders of magnitude. Biological tissue to ultrasound is very much like water to light. So we can see through biological tissue very clearly using ultrasound. Yet here, we're acquiring optical contrast in order to have molecular specificity. We're combining optical contrast with ultrasonic resolution in a single hybrid manner. By inverting the data, we can form a tomographic image. Photoacoustic tomography is omniscale imaging, ranging from organelles through cells, tissues, all the way to organs or even some animal organisms. And you can see this dashed line roughly connects all the different implementations of photoacoustic tomography. And we can always provide roughly 200 pixels in the depth direction to provide high resolution imaging. This slide shows the first functional, also the first in vivo photoacoustic tomographic images, which was demonstrated in small animals with an intact scalp and skull. Very similar to functional MRI, we can see the functional response of the brain on one side if we stimulate the whiskers on one side. This paper stimulated growth of our field. As you can see in this chart, after 2003, our field has grown exponentially. So the paper I just showed has become one of the two most cited papers in our field. Since 2010, the conference on photoacoustics has become the largest at the 20,000 attendee Photonics West. Now it's the largest by far. Since a couple of years ago, our field has published within each year 1,000 peer-reviewed journal papers and many citations per year as well. Let me show you the more recent progress. Early on, we demonstrated functional imaging using a single element transducer, which took about 20 minutes to acquire a full data set for a 2D image. Now we can get 3D images very fast within tens of microseconds. This is a demonstration where we have functional connectivity and functional response in 3D small animal brain. And this is a whole rat brain. You'll see the color changes, which is the functional response with the stimulation. And this is stimulation on the other side. And we toggle the stimulation on and off to show the response. And we scaled up our system for human scale imaging. This is one of the first images we acquired in human breast in vivo. With a single laser shot, we can acquire 2D cross-sectional image. The image was acquired within 150 microseconds. Within a single breath hold, 15 seconds, we can acquire a full 3D image to minimize any breathing-induced motion artifact. The smallest vessel diameter we can image is a quarter of a millimeter without injecting any exogenous contrast agents. And we can provide 4 centimeter penetration. And we recently developed a 3D breast imaging system. And you can see nearly isotropic image resolution in all three dimensions, and we can see the whole breast. And this is a comparison with MRI, which required injection of gadolinium as a contrast agent. We can also look at some of the mechanisms, hemodynamic response mechanism. This was done using our microscopic version of the system in a mouse brain. You can see a wave due to stimulation, both the oxygen saturation and the total hemoglobin concentration showed a wave propagation. You can look at the detailed time response. You can see here the oxygen saturation response much faster than the total hemoglobin concentration. The response times are different by a factor of 10. And so we're looking at a single capillary level type of response, and this can potentially help us understand the hemodynamic coupling, the neurovascular coupling for a hemodynamic mechanism. And we modified our breast version for brain imaging. And this is maybe too detailed for this slide, but just give you a rough idea. You can see the head is positioned in the gantry, and we used a system that has 2 megahertz transducer frequency. At 1064, we can measure the baseline mode or functional mode, and we can switch to another wavelength at 694 nanometers as well. And this is a real session with finger tapping. You can see the response right here at the close up. And this was a hemicraniotomy patient. And we'll wait for another cycle. The movie was sped up by 5 times. And so you can see a clear response due to finger tapping. And this is a more detailed
results from subject 1, 7T MRI on the left, functional PACT on the right. Individual functions are flashed in, starting with finger tapping, lip puckering, tongue tapping, passive listening, and silent word generation. Vessels for co-registration are then labeled 1 through 4, vessel 1 and 2 being superficial temporal artery, 3 and 4 being cortical arteries. The images are overlaid, and then individual functions are flashed in, starting with finger tapping, lip puckering, tongue tapping, passive listening, and silent word generation. The vessels are again pointed out individually, vessel 1 and 2 being branches of the superficial temporal artery, 3 and 4 being cortical vessels. The lateral perturbations allow for visual spatial appreciation of the co-registration. The images are then separated, and native T1 masks are faded in. Again, 7T MRI on the left, functional PACT on the right. Individual functions are then flashed in, starting with finger tapping, axial, and coronal images through the area of interest are introduced below. Next, lip puckering, tongue tapping, passive listening, and silent word generation.
So you can see exciting images using our technology, but the next hurdle we need to overcome is the skull attenuation and aberration. So there's a wavefront aberration we need to correct. We've done preliminary work using ex vivo skull. This is adult human skull. In fact, this work was published quite some time ago. So we've been working on, in this direction for quite some time. And this is the sagittal CT image. And this is a photograph of the skull. We put a canine brain inside the skull, try to image it. And our initial data already show the feasibility. So there is enough energy for us to go through the skull and still stay within the safety limit and get sufficient signal. And in fact, we imaged a healthy adult human brain transcranially. And in fact, there are two versions. We digitally flattened the skull just to see where's inside of the brain. And you can see certain features inside the brain. You can see right here. And so there's, again, even in vivo, we show that we can image the brain cortex using photoacoustics. So let's analyze the signal-to-noise ratio, which is a key question. Currently, we're getting signal-to-noise ratio at 50:1 for a hemicraniotomy patient. So this is without skull. And let's analyze what happens if we add a skull in. The skull is going to attenuate roughly by a factor of 2, but attenuate sound by a factor of 5. So we have a factor of 10 attenuation. The SNR, if you do nothing, SNR would be only 5:1. With this grant, we will increase the reading exposure to by 4 times. This is still within the ANSI safety limit. The ANSI does not regulate the total energy per laser pulse, but only regulates energy per area. And so we have a big factor to improve by using more fluence or more radiant exposure. And we can increase element count. 1,000 is already a record in our field. 2,000 even will be a new record. And it'll improve SNR by square root of 2. And then we can increase element size and still achieve a reasonably high resolution within maybe about 1 to 2 millimeters. And that allows us to improve the SNR by a factor of 4. So the total enhancement will be more than 100. We can more than recover the original SNR, even in the presence of skull. The targeted performance, including spatial resolution of 0.8 to 1.7 millimeters, SNR of greater than 100, temporal correlation better than 80%, area under the curve for ROC is more than 80%. And our first targeted human experiment is gonna be in Q1 of year 3, because we're building our system as we speak. Here's up-to-date project status. In Q1, we placed the order of the data acquisition system. We've optimized the ultrasonic transducer design. We designed the preamplifiers and electronic connectors. We're gonna work in quarter two on the following tasks. Contact manufacturer to finalize the procedure for manufacturing, place the order, test the preamplifiers, and prepare the mechanical drawings for the scanning system. Thank you very much.